his artistic path, and hopefully also about the beautiful sculptures and how they are made. So, the floor is yours.
Well, I have to thank you to Paolo first, because for his invitation, I much appreciate it, and he did a great job. Thank you very much. And thank you to everybody here, and I have to thank you also the consul from the Consulate of China for his great attention given to my presentation, Mr. Zhang Jiexing. And so, welcome to everybody, and Huang Ying, well, Hang Gao Xin, Li Zai Jili. And so, this lecture will be not a lecture like an academic lecture, but I want to show you a little bit how was my exploration, which it was, as you will see, pretty different, because usually people, they start with figurative sculpture, and me, I did the opposite. I started with abstract, more conceptual, as you would see, and after I became realistic, and I trained all my, so you will see how was my exploration. By the way, the travel is a very important part of my life, as you said, Mr. Paolo. So here I will show some picture which I never showed to any other country before.
Whoa.
Yes. So I decide to show tonight as the first time. So I start when I was 14 years old with art, to be an artist, and I went to the school, art school. And when everybody, usually in the art school, they start to make figures and drawing, I start to make I was doing this kind of installation. I was just 15 years old. I never showed this to anybody, and today I decided to show. And so 15 years old, you know, people, what do they do? They go around, they go to the movie. And me, I was going around and taking pictures. I was experimenting. So I was trying to find some things in the nature which inspired me and made a composition, try to compose. This kind of object and remind me something, put together, stone. And here even I start to draw on the stone, on the nature, which usually now is getting very popular. Now it's very popular. I mean, I didn't know it was. Became so popular today. But this I'm talking about 1980, more than 30 years ago, 35 years ago. So I was trying to also, with the shadow, try to make this composition. And of course the figures are very important here. I try to put together and make like a sitting man with a head on top. Here, this is stomach. This is just a sitting.
Is the photography yours?
Yes, this, I was just at the beginning, I bought my camera and start to learn. So here, after I finished my art school, I moved to Tuscany, to Carrara, which it was, and still now, is a very important art academy, very old, from the 1700s, lots of tradition, especially with marble, obviously. I don't know if everybody knows the Carrara marble. And so, as you can see, the building is constructed with marble. That's marble, it's not just a normal stone. So, and I went there, and my dream was to start to work with this material, the marble, which it was something like, for me, I was thinking about Michelangelo, all the great master, this luxury material, very hard. But at the same time, my research was abstract. Most of the people in the academy, we were working. Abstraction, it was very common. Not very much with figurative, unfortunately, I would say now. So I started to make my own creation, and the creation is, I was very inspired by the surrealistic and the surrealism. And in this case, I didn't make any model, I just go with my mind inside the block and try to take it out of the sculpture, which is pretty hard, but you get the inspiration on the way. So this is also, this is bronze, and I had the facility and the fantastic possibility to make my own bronze inside the academy. So the academy, it was very important for me because nearly 50% of the students were foreigners. It's a very international academy, very famous. People came from all over the world, from Asia, from America, from South America. For me, as an 18 years old person, came from a small town, I was kind of, it was fascinating. Plus, outside the academy, there was a big, large community of artists from all over the world, and even very famous artists, they came to Carrara to produce his own work. So the environment, it was very stimulating. This one I made in a different way. I made the first model, and after in the traditional way with a machine, I tried to take the shape from the model to the marble. This sculpture, about this is about 1 meter, about 1 meter is about 3 feet. And the other one is about 4 feet, the previous one. So this one is the same shape, but this is a terracotta. So I was making my own kiln. I fired by myself, which it was kind of very difficult. It's like a prehistorical firing, which is a very delicate and very difficult to control the texture, the color. But this, I think, is very fascinating. So I was making my own kiln to fire the sculpture. So at the same time, here is my drawing. The idea, the concept, I was very fascinated about, very simple. Just one line. With a line, and try to get the three-dimensional of the sculpture, of the drawing. And with a little chiaroscuro, this kind of, in this way here is, this case is watercolor. And here I start to feel like I was interested in the East, in Asia, Asia art. It's already, here it was just beginning. We are talking in 1985, 84. And here also the line, I was very, very simple, more simple, minimalistic as possible. With the line and make it like give an expression to the figure, which is very hard. You have to train a lot, and very many times it doesn't come out very well. So this is just the line, very simple, as much as it was possible, the simplicity. And here I start to put together the figurative, which I was not doing much in the sculpture, mainly, you see here, this is ceramic. It's a tail from the floor. I went to work in a factory, and I started working engraving the tail. And I put together the figurative, as I said, and together with the abstraction. Because the figurative, it was something inside of me I was a little bit interested, but it didn't come out so strongly. And here you see also the abstract, the sculpture, and the classicism. I was also fascinated about the classic, the Greeks, the Mediterranean culture. This is ceramic also, it's a tale. And so finally, my love for China came out like a bomb inside of myself. So I didn't finish my academy, and suddenly, before finishing, I decide I want to go to China. Everybody said, well, why you want to go to China? I mean, you almost finished the art academy. I said, I don't know, I'm interested, I want to go there. I'm interested in the great culture of China. And so, 21 years old, I stopped my art academy and I went to China by myself with the Trans-Siberian Express. all the way. So it was something crazy because it's even difficult to buy the tickets and all the way, all the, you know, that time we are talking about Russia, it was a communist. So it was under Soviet Union. It was closed, very difficult to get in. And I was traveling until Mongolia. So it was an incredible trip, very difficult to get all the permission and all the visa. We are talking about 1986. And so I arrived in Beijing, I had some contact there, I knew some very important professor at the university, and so I started my experience in China and traveling. And this lasted for, I didn't stay only in China, but I traveled all over Asia for a year and a half. This is, what happened to this picture? Sorry about this. And so this is an article all about me. I wrote with 17 pages, all my images, all my story. It's the monthly magazine from Milan, a very important magazine. And so when I came back, lots of media, they started to talk about my trip. It was very interesting, with lots of pictures. And so the newspaper gave to me even just one page all about me. I was just 22 years old. And so I came back and I continued with my art academy. And here, so I tried to put together all my experience. So when I was traveling, I get inspired by the scenery, the culture, the people. So in this case, here, for example, it's a similar like the previous sculpture, but it's totally different. So here the idea is the ocean, and the same time is the scenery. This, for me, I got inspired by the hills of South China, Guangxi area, which I was traveling. So I tried to put all this together like a dream. That's the surrealism, you know. So this is ceramic, it's only one piece. So here is also the graphic. This is a Chinese. This was a drawing I did in China. It was in the Yunnan area, in the Dali. And plus, in China, I got all the information because when I came back and I finished my art academy, I wrote my thesis about China also. So a book like this with all the pictures and information all about China. So this is also the same, it is a ceramic. And this also you can see there is the Asia, the Far East, Chinese, Japanese culture is coming out. All together but with my own expression. Different. This is more Mediterranean. I was working with the ceramic a lot. This is made by wheels. I throw by wheels, and after I made the sculpture. So I made the bird.
This may be a stupid question, but are these hollow?
Yes, you see. True, it's a base. At the beginning was like a base, and after I changed and created and made like a sculpture.
How do you shape it? Thank you. Sorry.
But you said it was on the wheel, so it's hard to see. You said it was on the wheel.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I'm telling you, because it's difficult to see. It was like a vase, and after you change it, you make a sculpture in hand, just a few touch and color. So this also is a ceramic during the same period. Here we are talking in the 1990s.
Where are these pieces, do you think?
It's a little bit all over China. It says, yeah, China is in Italy, private collection.
Where are they now?
Different places. So this is also ceramic, and as you can see here is a figure. So I started to try to combine more and more the figures and the abstraction. So very simple. So becomes almost abstract, everything, with the color. I was experimenting. And here, even more. So I'm getting very, the material, cut out the color, just a few parts. As you can see here, it's almost cracking. So I was interested about this, the exaggeration of the real material.
Were you doing this in the famous ceramic making towns in China?
No, this is still, we are talking in Italy. This went after I came back from China. So I was working in a different factory. This I did when I was in Tuscany. And here also is a shape of some other sculpture. So I got this, for example, is an inspiration about my trip in Australia. I found some shape of nature, the coral, the sea, and all this is an impression. I come back and start to work and find out these shapes and color. And here also starts is the beginning of my figure today. So here is lots of inspired by, I don't know if you know, is Arturo Martini. Arturo Martini is one of the greatest artists during the fascism in Italy, so the 30s and 40s. And so the simplicity of his images, that was very, I mean, it's a very important school in Italy. We study a lot. So here I get inspired by him. And after I finished my art academy, what happened? I got a great chance to work at the Musée du Louvre, Louvre Museum in Paris. So I was just 25 years old, my curriculum was good, I had this chance that they invite me and they said, we need a restorator this. And this it was a very important beginning for me, because it was very prestigious, hard work. And this it was the biggest restoration they ever done in Louvre in 1900. In 20th century. It was huge, enormous. So we completely changed some parts. And I started to work, and this it was the carving. So I was carving in the wall of the Louvre. So the sculpture in the wall. So if you make a mistake, you can't change it. So very important to be very precise. We worked together with architects, and if it was a mistake, it was really a huge problem. And I worked there and lived in Paris for 2 years. And to work in the Louvre and in Paris, for me, it was incredible. It was like, inside of me, it was like a washing machine. I changed completely, and all the time close to the classical work, it came out something inside of me, and I said, wow, the classical, it's fantastic, it's amazing. The sculpture, making faces and all this. So to make a sculpture like this, it was a really challenge, huge, enormous. And I felt like I want to learn more and more and more and more. So after 2 years in Paris, I moved and I started to travel in Africa, because in Paris, I started to learn a lot about the African culture. And so I went by boat to Africa, to Senegal, from Europe, sailing boat. And after I started to travel from Senegal, and here is Mali. And I was in contact with the director of the Bamako Art Museum, and I had a cooperation with him. So I made the research in the sculpture, Bambara, Dogon, and the ceramic. The ceramic here was, they still make it like 3,000 years ago in Europe. It's unbelievable. Something you can see here, the women, mainly the women are working. And I was so amazed about this work. In a way, also my sculpture, the one I made with a kiln, which I constructed the kiln, it was a little similar concept. But these people, they still make it to use this material. So this is everything is by hand. It was completely in the countryside, very far away, very difficult to get there. Only because some local people, they give me a suggestion to be there, to get there.
Why do you suppose it was only the women who did the
work? Yeah, that's amazing. I mean, all the women, they make all the works completely, and they go to the market, they sell, and the men, they don't do it. That's
is
very
it impressive. Possibly because the women are the ones who are going to be using the pots?
I don't think so. It's more related to the culture and the religion, I suppose. So this, it was fired outside, like 3,000 years ago. And the color is made with seeds, fruits from the trees. So it was incredible. So all this, I published some article later in Italy, where I was describing all this. So you see this and the fire, it's incredible.
How do they control the fire?
Well, that's is a technique, so they have to, yeah, it's very amazing, because the most important is how you put all the ceramic for to get a ventilation, that's most important. But still, 20% of the base, the container breaks, obviously. And after this, so I went back to Europe, and with the same film as I said before, after the Louvre, I said I want to work with figure, but the figurative is very hard. It's very difficult. It's very challenging. You need a training. So I moved back to Europe and I went to a school of specialization in wood carving, and I started to copy the classic, the great master. So this is a copy of Donatello I did in wood, and the original is in Bargello in Florence. Very important. It's Niccolò da Uzzano. So very hard work, but I really wanted to study. Usually this kind of stuff you do when you're 18 years old in the art academy, but nobody does anymore in Europe. And even in the US, very few places. So this is a Donatello, the original is in bronze in Padova, in the cathedral. So this is very important for me because I forgot completely all my concept to be an artist, to be creative, but I really wanted to learn the skill, how to really get back to the master. So this is a Venice, the original is in the Museo Archeologico in Florence. It's a copy from the Roman Empire. It's a cherry tree. And this is a Tilman Schneider, this is the Michelangelo of Germany, it's a 1500. So I want to show this because all they are different. You see different style. So different style means it's very challenging, very difficult to learn all different style. From the classical to the Renaissance to this Renaissance in Germany, which is totally different. So this is, you have to really learn a lot. And this also starts with the figures in from the life size. This is the life size figure.
That's also wood?
No, this is a plaster.
Oh, plaster. Okay.
Now in bronze. Like, yeah. So this, I don't know if you can read. I want to show you this because this is an important point for me. Finish my specialization. I want to move to US, to New York, to the New York Art Academy, which is the most prestigious art academy in US for figurative arts. So I apply, I made an examination, and I pass. Can you read a little bit? Mm-hmm. And so I want to show this because it was really good. I was very happy, and I got two scholarship to study, but unfortunately the scholarship was not enough to start to study. So what happened? I really wanted to come. And the people there that were really happy, and they started to call me back in Italy. They said, Dionisio, are you coming? And me, I said, still, I didn't find the support. I was asking in Italy for the Minister of Foreign Affairs and everything. So finally, in the end, I was not able to go. It was terrible. It was for me really, usually, I don't give up easily. But this, I didn't have the money, no chance. So, I give up, and this was MFA, the master. So, what happened? I got some kind of small depression, but I don't give up. I said, I can't say no. So, there was the big competitor academy in Russia, in St. Petersburg. Big, the most famous in Russia, and all the Chinese also go there for study, and from India, from Korea. So finally I made an application there, and I get there, it was much cheaper, and I went to Russia right away. and then moved to St. Petersburg. And I made my post degree there. And so I started to continue my research in figurative, because still it was a long way. So I started to draw and get, do you remember my drawing in the beginning? Very different. And now I get back here, start to work very hard to get really the skill to understand the technique of how to draw. So before I was not interested. I was able because but I was not interested. It was not my target. So I started to work all this figurative, which usually takes years to train. And this was also, and this time I started to be very interested in a portrait, because a portrait, I think it was very interesting for as an expression. So here we are talking about 1997, 98. So here, this was a writer. Originally, he was from Prague. Good friend of mine, and I made his portrait. Thank you. So as you see, every portrait is pretty different, because I try to get the soul of the personality, the person, and try to, so one is more smooth, one is less smooth, one is harder, one is softer. Because I try to study the person. It's not just like to make it look same. It's not what I want. So everyone, so you see, for example, if I'm going back, this one is a very melancholic person, which she was like that. The other one is a more like an intellectual, but with a stronger personality. This. So this, I found this model, which it was incredible, fantastic. And everybody asked me, say, why is so slim and interesting? It was very difficult because you could see all the anatomy, all the muscle, everything. Very hard, very slim. And I said, I never saw a person like that. I said, I want to, you pose for me. Everybody said, oh, we're surprised. So I made a model. I spent 2 months to make this three-quarter of life. Try to make as much as possible close to the reality. But at the same time, I finished to study. I said, I have to start to show my work. And here was a great show in Potsdam, in Berlin, just in front of the Royal Castle. It was a, so I show everything. It was my figurative, my drawings, my abstract, all together. And at the same time, I had this great opportunity. I get invited by Claudio Abbado, Maestro Claudio Abbado, which is one of the greatest conductors. He invited me personally to show all my exhibition to my work and inside the Philharmonie, which is a great architecture tour. This is one of the greatest architects from Germany, Schönbrunn, which usually people, they go to Germany and go and see the architecture. And so I had all my solo show inside for 6 weeks inside this building. So this is a Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. This is a really important place. So it was a great honor and great luck for me to get in with my work. So here at the same time, I start to work also in Scandinavia. And I found some clients. They asked me portraits. They knew my portrait. So I moved to Oslo. I opened my own studio, and I made several of this. Portraits. So this is a lady, it was a... So you see, this is a very smooth, it was totally different personality. So sometimes even looks like the artist is another, but because I try to follow the personality of the people. So all these are in bronze. This was a young girl, 11 years old. At the same time, I continue with my restoration. This, I had a great opportunity here. They called me, this is the private church of the Queen in Denmark, Copenhagen, inside the castle. And that was the leader sculptor there and restorator. And I restore all the big sculpture inside. Usually it's close to the palace.
It's only for the queen.
So as you can see, this is marble, and all this sculpture with a relief. This is an old picture. I reconstruct pieces after the big fire. All the chapel collapsed. So I spent all my big, very long time to restore and repair all this big sculpture. So this, for me, it was a chance to study and to get money to continue with my work also, because life of an artist is very hard. So it's really much up and down. And this gave me a chance to make a very good money and to study from the classical. So this, it was a great opportunity. So as you see, this is a big work, and sculpture sometimes were missing parts, and I reconstruct completely new. So this, it was, this is in Strasbourg in France, one of the most famous cathedrals. It's from the Middle Age. So I was working on the sculpture of the 12 and 1300. I reconstruct completely in stone. But this I touched just a little bit. This is a great, one great George Street, close to Downing Street in Westminster, in London. And I was the responsible for the Great Hall, which has been commemorated by the Queen in 1978, the opening. And I was the responsible for all the sculpture. And at the same time, I was teaching at the university as a guest lecturer in the Wimbledon School of Art. So this was a marble and stucco. Of course, marble is my specialization, which I carry from Carrara. And that's the the portal after I finished the work. As you see, this is all marble, and on the top is all stucco. And this, it's the Royal Palace of Stockholm, and a Spaniard who was working also there. And this is the Riddarhuset, is the most important building of Scandinavia. He's a Dutch architect, but very, very famous. It's amazing, incredible project. And I was working there too. So I want to show you just a couple of things about restoration. I have another lecture which I'm talking about only restoration. Today is a big paradigm. So this, I want to show you how they give it to me, the work, for example. That's how it was at the beginning. So totally damaged, that's a stone. And after that, after I finish. And I reconstruct it with a special chemical concrete. And after, you have to give the patina, which will look all the same. So as you can see here, that's the original part, the original color, and that's all my reconstruction, the clear, the white. Please.
So obviously, I guess you had done your research to know what it looked like originally.
Oh sure, I was working with the original. They give it to me, all the drawing, the picture, and the photo. Yeah, sure.
So you just are trying to very emulate that.
Sometimes you have a similar, so you can copy, you can find, you can make a mold. Some other time, like in the Louvre, they give to me all the copy of the original drawing and design from the archive. So it was very complicated.
And how long did that take?
Only this?
Yeah.
Something like this takes about roughly 5 days.
5 days?
1 week.
What? Oh my God. That's fast.
That's fast.
That's good. Yeah.
What materials is it?
This is stone and concrete. Because if it's totally damaged, like you see before in the roof, I was carving completely new in stone. But this is mixed because it was a little damaged, so they want to preserve as much as possible the original part in stone. So all this, it was because I want to get my perfection, to learn as much as possible the skill to get here. So do you remember this, the model I did in Russia? So I get in my mind, for years I had this sculpture, but I was almost scary to do it, because I said it's too difficult what I have in my mind. But I couldn't sleep anymore. I couldn't work anymore, because this sculpture became soft. And I tried to treat the marble like it looks really the drapery. And the skin, it looks like a skin. So I tried to use it. Sometimes I was not able to work because it was too difficult. So I went and I tried to make a tools just for what I need. Like they did in the 15 or 1600 during the Renaissance. And that's you can still do in Italy. Very, very less and less and less. But still you can do it. So, and after this, I finished my work, I start to have some several exhibition, and they called me as a guest lecturer in the most famous, the biggest university of Saudi Arabia, King Saud University. So, I was teaching there undergraduates and graduates, and even a PhD professor. So this was a great opportunity, great success. So this was all the poster, it's around the university. For my lecture and my workshops. And this is, Al Jazeera is one of the most important cultural newspaper. So as here is with the president of the university, here during my work, that's me, here I was teaching here. And for this workshop, even the very famous sculpture came from all over the country. That's, it was amazing. So after this, what happened? Start in 2004 when I was in Saudi Arabia, I got an email from a friend of mine, Lucy Liu, which is huge. She's a writer. She was a friend of mine. She lives in London, and we became very good friends when I was in London. And she published a book. And this book was Afternoon Tea. So all experience, her experience in London. And she said, Dionisio, I wrote a book and the last chapter is only about you. I want you come, I want to invite you in Beijing. I said, wow, in Beijing now? So I was a little bit surprised. But at the same time, I really wanted to go back to China. Because in 1986, what I saw, and after I heard that lots of people to China changed the boom in the economy and everything, I was so curious to see China. From 1986, and this, we are talking 2004. So I said, yes, of course, I'm coming. I came and went to Beijing for the launching. And after that, they called me several universities for give some lectures, and I moved to Shanghai. And Shanghai, wow, I've been so surprised about this city, the energy, the atmosphere, all the situation. I was impressed. So I stayed there, I said, why not to be here for a few months? It's an incredible city with a big, so many things going on. And I started to teach. And at the same time, I had my first exhibition in Shanghai and with great success. And so everything, it was like a rolling, like a ball, and starting, and big energy came from the city, and I got big energy to work, and it was working like 7 days a week, almost, all the time. So, and this it was the exhibition. This is a very important, famous artist. He was a professor from the Shanghai University, so he came for the opening, so it was a great honor too. And this, it was another great opportunity. A real estate, one of the biggest real estate, Zhongkai in Shanghai, they offered me a cooperation for a huge project of villa, 81 villas, luxury, very expensive. And they called me and they said, Dionisio, we want you as an art director. I said, art director for an architecture project? I said, it's weird. Why? I was kind of surprised. They said, no, we need you. I said, I'm a sculptor. That's what we need. We need your experience. So finally, he presents to me this project, and I get amazing. Dude, the project was incredible. So every villa was like a piece of art, and with a very important architect. It was 10 different architects, studios, all from US. And one of them, so that's 81 villas like this. So we are talking about each villa was between $20-25 million. So, And they, okay, I want to say this, the all our signing contract ceremony was inside the Shanghai Museum. It's not a random museum, so to let you understand what it was, the caliber of this real estate. So with the presentation, with all the media, it was amazing. So this is one of the most famous villas. This is made by Mark Scoggin, former dean of the Harvard University. And he made a project for 5 villas. So I've been working on this project for 5 years.
What were you doing actually?
I was doing a lot of different things, mainly checking the quality. Working together with architects, so there were like wood, stone, marble. Lots of stone was coming from Paris, the same stone in which I was working in the Louvre. So that's why I was specialized on this kind of stuff. That's why the architects, they didn't know exactly as much me how to work. So I was training also the worker there. And plus make a presentation to the media, international media, for marketing. So this is Domus Plus China. Do you know the famous Domus magazine, which is from Italy, but it's international all over the world. Only one magazine talks only about this project. So a full magazine dedicated to this Zhongkai Shishan business. But at the same time, I was going to continue with my own work. But I want to find a changing and find a material which, for me, represent Chinese culture. I didn't want to continue with marble, because for me, marble represent more Italy, and bronze represent more the Western. But I want to see. When you say China, you say porcelain, and everybody thinks about porcelain. So, Jindajian is the place where the most famous porcelain has been created in China since the Tang Dynasty. So I went to Jindajian, and I get fascinated about this material, but I didn't know the porcelain. It was totally for me unknown, the material, which I thought probably was similar with ceramic, but I realized it was totally different. So I moved to Jindajian, I opened my own studio, and I started to create the children as you see here. I bring it here, the wood one, because that's the original sculpture. And from the wood, I made the mold. You need a 3 different mold to make the porcelain. Now, I want to show also a little bit the skill, because most of people, I don't know how many of you knows the skill, how to make it, the porcelain. I'm not sure. So I want to show you a little bit how is the process, which is a pretty complicated and long. So after 3 molds, this is the last. 3rd mold is in plaster. And this is the porcelain. And the porcelain Jindajian is one of the most beautiful in the world. They have a different kind, but it's incredible. So the porcelain comes from here. That's the original place. Jindajian is a 1 hour by flight from Shanghai. So I was traveling with airplane all the time. And here I have several assistants helping me for this work, because I produce and it's a lot of work to make it all together. So as you see, this is the porcelain, it's inside. And you have to cut by pieces. So this is the body. Only the body, but you see it's only one leg, because the other leg is separate. And after it's closing, and that's how it looks like. These are only 3 pieces.
So it's still missing. Made of clay, isn't it?
Excuse me?
It's still made of clay?
Yes, it's almost like a clay, but it's a different kind of clay. It's like a clay. But it's, you know, we call kaolin. I don't know if you ever heard of this. And kaolin is coming from China. Close to Jindajian, there is a little village where they take the clay, and the name is Kaolin. And that's where it's coming from, this word, since 1,000 years, several 1,000 years. So, and after you have to put together all this piece, and you have to finish it, because every time is, you see all the piece, you have to put together, so it's lots of things you have to clean and finish everything. And all the pieces, I got my assistants helping me, but all the finishing, the most important work, it was done by me, each one. So here is, after I finished the piece, you have to paint. This is the basic paint, which is the most important in a way. But the problem was the fire this. I didn't know the porcelain. So everybody, when I get in China, they said, in Xinjiang, people, they said, you can't do this. This, you cannot. I said, why? Because this, you can't put it in fire. I said, come on, why not? And I said, this is like we can stand and live. And finally, I realized they were right. It was crazy, this work to make. So I started to create all this system by myself. I was thinking at night, I couldn't sleep, how to fire this. Because as if you know the porcelain, usually in China, is this kind of shape. Why? Because they have to support themselves. Very important, because this is fire is a 1,300 degree, which is in Fahrenheit 2,500, roughly. So very high temperature, more than how to when you cast bronze. So it was really dangerous. So several children just destroyed, didn't come out. But I didn't give up. You can't do that. I will do it. You can't do that. And me, I said, no, I will do it. No way. And I said, if it will break, we make a new one. So some Chinese, some assistant, they didn't want to come and help me because they were too scared. Say, no, you can't do that. But they said, if it's broken, it's my problem. But they, so finally, and that's the most difficult part. When you pass that part, you say, phew. So I was really looking forward to open the kiln and see the work, if it was coming out well. So here's the second part, is the decoration. The decoration is all hand painted, and this kind of decoration is a traditional Chinese. But I change the color, I change the composition to make something more different. So this is a lot of work. And as you see here, the color are totally different. So you have to think how it will be after the fire, after put in the kiln again. And this is the last part, but every sculpture usually is fired at least 3, 4, even 5 times. The one with the square is 5 times fire. The one with the flower is 4 times, because the gold doesn't come properly, the color doesn't come. So, came out, you have to repaint again, or retouch on top, and refire. And after the firing is not good enough, you have to repaint again, so it's a long work. So each piece takes roughly 6 weeks each. So it's a lot of work.
So what on the slide before this, that was kind of pretty. What was wrong with that?
Thank you. I hope we're no more pretty than that.
But no, I guess my question is that not unusual enough? Is that why you kept going, or
what do you mean?
Well, that's what. Why did you keep trying to find different decoration patterns? Yes.
So why did change it?
No, she's just not understanding that with pottery or porcelain, is that you have to, after you've cooked it for a little bit, then you paint, and then the pigment changes as you cook it again.
Right.
Oh, because you have to keep cooking.
Yeah.
So
and it needs.
If you keep like this, it's like a dust.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Okay.
Stay on.
I got it.
It has to be fired again.
But it's a lower temperature than the before.
Yes. Okay.
The first one is the highest.
Right.
These are lower.
Okay.
So it's the less dangerous to fire, and you can fire it many times.
Right. No wonder it takes 6 weeks. It's a long process.
So this, the last fire, so it's very special, and always it's like a baby. You don't know what's coming out. You know? And that's the result after it's finished. So after this is the pedestal. It's also in porcelain. You have to make a system to put together everything. It's a very old style. So even the system, how to fix, takes a very long time with the copper inside. It's like a high-end craft.
Whom did you use for a model?
Excuse me?
Who was your model?
For this?
Yeah.
This is interesting because this shape I get inspired by an old sculpture from De La Quercia. Jacopo de la Quercia is a 1400 sculptor from Italy, which he was the master of Michelangelo Buonarroti, but not so well known, very important. I found this sculpture was great, so I get inspired. It's difficult, it's different, and but it's a little similar. I found this not well known, this sculpture, but I found so fascinated, this child, this position was very beautiful. And became more modern, but the origin is for 1400.
How many of them did you make?
This is seven altogether.
Seven?
Seven pieces. So everyone is different.
Oh, only seven?
Yes.
Sir, since you have lived in Oslo, you are familiar with the big man.
Of course, sure. I was living just very close.
Right, and when I walked in, there are a couple of his sculptures in the park. They made me think of a couple of those sculptures of him.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Sinatagen.
Yes.
Yes,
I know Vigna Park. I live just less half mile from the Vigna Park. It's very close. So all this sculpture has been exhibited at the Biennale in 2011 in Venice. These are made for all these samples of the Beijing Olympic Games, because I did during the Olympic Games I did my solo exhibition. It was part of the program of the Olympic Games. So to commemorate this, I made this sample, which I found very beautiful. Looks like a little bit from the old Hanzi, like a character from China, old China, which was very beautiful. And by the way, all this technique is all traditional Chinese. The color are all Chinese. It's nothing changed. So I use everything looks like a Chinese tradition from porcelain.
So what's the reason for you to put your name on all of it?
This it was a start as a joke, but it was an idea for. I liked the idea of the characters, which I found very beautiful. It was for me like a painting. It represents very much the Chinese culture. And the name became for me like a logo for fashion. If you write down like Fendi, Armani, or Gucci, I say, why I can't write my name on the sculpture? So I put together, and this is the character, which I found very aesthetical. It looks like art, artistic, and I found a and plus, I said Chinese, they will learn my name, which is very difficult.
That's pretty. Wow.
So it's a combination of these art. I try to combine elements from my culture, Italian culture, Western culture, with the elements of China. So my sculpture, usually in China, people they recognize right away because they are not Chinese, but they are not European. So it's Dionisio sculpture. And that's why many people remember.
Wow.
This is a craquelé. This sculpture is exhibited there. This is shiny like a stainless steel, but it's a porcelain. It's a special technique, a special color.
Wow.
It looks like a stainless steel.
It does look like water.
Yeah. And also this to fire, it was kind of, it's also you need the support because it's all hollow, it's empty on the back. And this was my exhibition in Beijing inside the Italian embassy during the Olympic Games. And this was a curator from the Tokyo Foundation, which is also the curator, had been a curator of Ai Weiwei, which everybody knows, and and he came from Tokyo just for my exhibition. So I was like, he was very kind. This was the poster. And finally, I decided to open my new studio in downtown in Shanghai. And I opened a new studio and I got a possibility because there was the expo in Shanghai. So they offered me to make a sculpture, which it was the anniversary of, I don't know how many of you knows Matteo Ricci. Matteo Ricci is very important in China. In China, is known as Li Mado, with a Chinese name. So it was his anniversary of his death, of 400 years, and he's originally from very close to my town. So the Italian government said, Dionisio, we want you make a sculpture for his anniversary, which it was for the Italian pavilion in Shanghai. So I start to create this work. Here I want to show you also how the sculpture is made. So how I start. So an illustration, brief description, step that, I mean, you can read also, it's big enough. I realize the Matteo Ricci sculpture for the anniversary of the creation exhibition in Italy, pavilion Shanghai World Expo. Interior, so this is the part of the interior, so it's all in metal, the structure. And here is the beginning of the clay. So you start very simple, obviously. And here is the process. As you see, put more and more and more clay. You start to construct the work. And here, so very systematic, very geometrical, and coming more. And after you start with more details, and here you start to see how big was the sculpture, close to me.
Wow.
So the sculpture was about 1 ton of clay, very heavy. So you see the develop of the sculpture changing. And of course this is with the traditional dress from China, which he was dressing at that time, that period, which it was very big respect during this time. He died in 1610, so that's why the expo was in 2010. And he was the first foreigner that had been sepulto. He's buried in China. His grave is in Beijing University, so everyone knows. So finish the sculpture here. We start with making the molding with the plaster, and I wanted to make all by myself because I want to keep the quality as much as was better. But it was very big work. I realized later, and that damaged even my knee, unfortunately. So you see all the process here, all the structure with the metal, and that's when it's finished. And when it's finished, we start to open. And that's very, very, very heavy. So one piece, this is about 600 pounds. So to remove, it takes several people. And here's the opening, and here's the cleaning, and the washing, and here is the pouring. Start to put back inside the plaster with all the structure, metal, wood inside. And here, my entrance, you see it was in downtown, it was not big enough, the door. So I need to ask 13 people to move because altogether it was roughly 1 ton of plaster. It was impossible without a machine. So we came because also the Italian television, they came next day for an interview. So I was rushing to prepare and to put out the sculpture. And here is after I break and take out the sculpture. So I destroyed the mold outside. And what I created before is coming out. And this is finished, the sculpture plaster. After finish the sculpture plaster, I start to make another mold, which is in silicone rubber. Another mold, again. And this is the finish with two of my assistants, make it a silicone rubber mold, the opening. And here is the opening of the silicone rubber. So inside you see is the molded plaster. And this is to pour in the resin, the silicone mold. Finishing this, the resin. This is a very, very short, so try to make it kind of very synthetic. And here is the calking and the preparing for surface for the gold leaf application. So you have to prepare the sculpture, special application for the gold leaf. And here, and the gold leaf is a very, very delicate work, has to be done in a very special environment, no dust, and you need a very special technique. So I put all the gold leaf, and the gold leaf that I bought in Japan because I wanted to have the best gold. In Japan, I have a great type of gold. And after that, I started with the calligraphy. So I need I need my assistant from Jin De Jian. So I call him, I invite him in Shanghai to my studio. And for more than 2 weeks, we start to paint the sculpture, which is 2,700 characters. It's a lot of work, all by hand. He is a very pretty famous calligraphy professional. So here was the presentation in my studio for the Shanghai World Expo, and they came with the media. This was the Director of Culture Institute, and came the ambassador, and all the presentation to the media, the television, the local. So this is the Italian ambassador who came before making the presentation inside the pavilion. And that's the sculpture when it was finished. And this was exhibited for 6 months inside the Italian pavilion, which is great because inside you have all the best made in Italy, and I was the only contemporary sculpture. So it was a great, great honor for me. So this work, it was altogether 6 months. That's the Italian pavilion, which it was a very beautiful. And now it belongs to the Chinese government, the Italian, and now became the Italian center. So in this case, it was the opening of the Ferrari Museum. Ferrari Museum is the only Ferrari museum outside of Italy, is in Shanghai, inside the Italian center. And so for the opening was also Mr. Ferrari. This is the son of Enzo Ferrari, is Mr. Pietro Ferrari. And he was there for the great opening of that day. And of course, my work now is a part of the collection there. It's a permanent collection. The other one is bought by the Italian government for the region of Matteo Ricci, and now is in a museum there. And this one, which is the plastic one, is in the collection there now. And this is a reconstruction of Palladio Theater, which is a very famous architect of 1500. It's a reconstruction. And this is a very famous art critic in Italy, which is making a program in television, in the national television. So he wants my work for his private library in Milan. But I didn't give it to him because of the Italian government bought. So he was not very happy. But still, he put my sculpture inside the program on the national television. This one, he was the curator of the Venice Biennale, Sgarbi, which after this, I knew him since many, many years. He was surprised to find me there. And after this, he invited me to the Venice Biennale show in 2011. So this was my last performance before I was leaving China. And so you see, on the right side is the entrance of Ferrari Museum. That's the exhibition. So I give this, the performance will last about 2 weeks inside the pavilion. And this is where now is located, the the sculpture there, and you can see also on internet. I can give you the address, and that's it. If you have any question, any...
Oops. Do we get to take some artwork with us? Do we get to take some artwork with us?
What's the next question?
Right.
And so you've been in California for a year?
Yes, I've been here because they invited me. I had a great project. I was a creative director in a very large studio in Monterey, Sculpture. And... So that's why I'm moving here. I got this offer, and now I'm just exactly 1 year, 2 days ago.
In San Francisco, or?
In Monterey.
Oh, Monterey?
Monterey.
So that's kind of what you do. You just go set up shop, let's say, to various cities where you can create something unique and...
Well, this offer was a really great offer, and the project was really big project, international project. So they contacted me and they said, Dionisio, we can offer you this position. It was, and I really wanted to move to U.S. as an experience, because I've been working all over the world, but never U.S. That's my first time. Many people, they could not believe. I said, how is it possible? I said, never. So I really took this possibility, this chance, that I really wanted to come here. And so now I'm here.
What is the project that you're working on in Monterey?
Monterey is a very large studio of sculpture, about 60 people, and I was a creative director. I was making huge monuments for several, we had a different exhibition, one in Singapore, one in Hong Kong, and so we have another studio in London, so I was flying and I had lots of people working together.
Still traveling the world.
Yes.
And so what's the next adventure?
That's the thing that I'm interested in looking forward for some very interesting new project in the U.S.
You seem very humble, but I guess everyone can say you're the modern day Michelangelo, right?
Well, that's too big, you know. I know the monster. I've been studying there and them, and this. I try to develop and try to find something. For me, the beauty, the aesthetic is very important. So I think the art can be new, but you can't delete and forget the beauty, the aesthetic. And the Pope, when he starts the first speech given to the public, he said, the beauty will save the world. And I was astonished to listen to this, because I believe on that. I believe on the beauty.
What
is the name of,
what did you name that sculpture?
And
that you did with the sheep?
Which one?
The tall one. What's the name of it?
It's Saint John the Baptist.
Saint John the Baptist.
So that's, I wanted to create a lot of people that made, especially in Italy, Saint John the Baptist, it was a very common subject, but I wanted to create something new, something different. Classical, but modern at the same time. So I tried to create, which is pretty different. Usually Saint John the Baptist has a fur, camel fur, and me, I'm a dragon, so totally different.
Is there a medium that you would like to try?
I try to experiment in media. You see, I've been working with wood, with stone, with bronze, with anything. So I like material very much, experimenting. So I don't know, I like challenge, and if there is a materials which I like, I can feel, I need a feeling. I need to see the material and I...
sense of it.
Yeah, if there is material which you don't like and it's very hard to work with, I don't feel, it doesn't give me any emotion. But material like the porcelain, right away I felt very strong emotion, which I found fantastic. Which was really difficult.
Any other?
Sorry. Thank you so much.
Thank you.